beat my brother-in-law half to death, lost $20 on his football bet. But other than that, we ain't nothing, just good old boys. Good old boys, we're all the same. Ain't no way we'll ever change.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning to you, sir.
How are you today?
Blessed and glad to be here.
How are you? Me too. Glad to be back. Seemed like a long, long week.
Says here it's cloudy. The Wade and Carter weather brought to you by the great folks at AT Deerland Feed.
Got a little something. Are we going to hit 100 today?
Got a little something for you.
Let me check and see what we're going to be.
747. Didn't think before deciding.
77 degrees in Victoria, Texas. Heading to a high today of 101 under cloudy skies. This could be the layover, what's left of Tropical Storm Hillary. It's made its way across the greatest country on earth.
Seems it never rains in
Well, it is this week.
It is this week. They got 2 inches in 2 hours.
2 inches in 2 hours. The video footage, it just really made me chuckle. It was 72 degrees and sunny in San Diego, and the weather guy, not they didn't get Jim Cantore out there for that.
No.
But the weather guy was wearing the nice Land's End style rain jacket with the Velcro cuffs, and then the collar was up. And he had his Weather Channel hat on. As you can see here, it's sunny right now. But and behind him are dudes. Are you good? Yes. My lady's waiting to hear from you. Behind him, you see a flotilla of some naval ships. So they weren't so worried they got those out of port.
No, wow.
And there's dudes on sea dudes running around the bay. And well, he's just like,
haven't had waves like that in California in a long time.
Folks, much ado about nothing, Gavin Newsom already decided to label California an emergency. It's in a state of emergency. It's the biggest joke ever. They showed...
Well, I wouldn't go there. I mean, they do have a lot of hills. They have been ravaged by wildfires. So,
which was worse, the 5.1 earthquake that happened out there or this rainstorm?
5.1, that's just every day in California.
They said they got 2 inches of rain in 2 hours. They showed water flowing through
the aqueducts, yeah.
The aqueducts in Las Vegas. And they showed the streets in Las Vegas being wet, and they were like, the horror. It's it's a storm.
You know, the only thing that I hope happens is this thing keeps pushing north.
We need some rain, Coach.
And it helps the fires that are going on in Oregon and Washington and southern British Columbia. I've got at least 3 friends who have lost homes in the fires in southern British Columbia. Guys that I've a good friend of mine, Mozo, in Australia. He tunes in every once in a while. His mom lost their cabin that had been in the family for decades. And then I've had 2 friends lose their homes in Kelowna, guys, people that I went to high school with. So the fires up that way are just absolutely crazy.
Now, we know that these wildfires are quite often natural phenomena that happen annually. And we can all agree that this has been a really, really, really hot summer. And that some of these fires, the heat, the fact that it's 110 degrees is not causing fires.
No.
So the ground is more susceptible to fire because of the dry conditions.
Yes.
But annually, when it's only 95 degrees for weeks at a time, the same situation exists. Are people setting these fires? Are these climate change terrorist fires?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question because they still have not. If you just didn't drink that water, there'd be water left to save.
Right. If only I didn't drink water. If I could just do without it, we could use it.
They still don't know the origin of the blaze in Hawaii and Maui. What torched all of Lahaina, which that worries me. I mean, what are they waiting on?
We had a fire out by your house. We knew within hours. There was only one report. There was never a rumor of an arsonist. It was like, hey, you know what? Somebody saw that transformer blow. Sparks went everywhere. Next thing you know, we got a fire. See, that's how things happen in reality.
Residents of Lahaina are suspecting it was down power lines, but they still haven't confirmed it.
There was a storm, yeah. Right?
Well, there was a tropical storm to the south, or a hurricane, and the winds were whipping. The Lahaina sees winds. The Northwest Territories, the city of Yellowknife, like 22,000 people have been evacuated because of fires around there.
Now, that's in
the Northwest Territories. That's way up. But over the weekend, I read a story. They caught six people trying to spark fires in and around the city of Yellowknife.
Those people, they should just be shot.
I agree completely.
Just shoot them.
And then yesterday, saw a headline in the Shuswap region of British Columbia that people are stealing the firefighting equipment. Those people should also be shot on site. No reason for it, no need for it. But and my cousin Jarrett checking in says Canada spends billions abroad but won't spend millions on forest management to compensate for interrupting natural cycles, pine beetle damage, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, and let's not forget that probably in an effort to fuel the climate change fire, pardon the pun, Justin Trudeau, early in the fire season, when Quebec was burning, northern Quebec had a pretty early start to the fire season. And as a result, when the U.S. offered help, Justin Trudeau said no. Now, why would you say no to a country that neighbors you and is offering help to fight your fires? And Canada often rushes to the aid of the U.S. when they have fires and Canada does not. But I don't recall anybody ever in the U.S. turning down help from Canada to fight fires, but Justin Trudeau did that early in the firefighting season. And when most of this country was gripped in smoke coming south from those fires in Quebec, Trudeau said, nah, we don't need your help.
I thought that was arrogant and short-sighted.
Oh, it absolutely
was. I mean, like,
was.
Hey, we got guys. But they're eager to jump in.
But I also, observation, because remember as a kid, Smokey Bear, remember him?
Only you can prevent forest fires.
Yeah. Well, what do they call them now? They're not forest fires anymore. They're wildfires. Right? Stoke fear. Because the forest is so far away, right? But when it's a wildfire, you just think, oh, it's right on my doorstep, or it could be right here.
Right.
Right? There's a reason they term it what they term it. But also, you have to remember, I remember as a kid growing up, always there were lots of forest fires.
There's lots of forest.
Exactly. You'd drive through the Rocky Mountains and you'd see the scars up on the side of the hill. It'd be right down to the highway. Nobody ever, but they were forest fires. But what's happened now, the same reason that our losses during hurricanes and such are so big, there's more people living in forests now than there ever were. Lakefront property in Canada is primarily in the forests. People are building there. So when there's a forest fire, well, sometimes these things have no place to go.
Linda Christ adds that Canada's on board with pushing the global warming narrative.
Absolutely.
Justin Spitalski said, don't use my name in common with that Canadian idiot. And he said, my comment was just flagged. The feds are listening. Hi, Fred. Hi, Larry. You guys tune in. Enjoy your coffee. Do you want to go check why Magic isn't on? And I'll do a quick. Why don't you bring it up right now? I'll do some commercials for you.
But that's what that's not a theory, but that's how they've switched the terminology to instill fear in people. And because more people are now living in and around the forests, they're no longer forest fires, they're wildfires.
So,
and the losses will be higher because more people are living in them.
Is it a lot like aliens from other countries? They're alien, they're not from here. Crossing our border illegally, that we used to call illegal aliens.
Yes.
They're now disenfranchised asylum seekers from underprivileged locales. And all we are, as people who want to uphold the rule of law, not institute new laws, we just want to uphold the rule of law and control our border.
Similar.
Then we're bad people.
Yeah, well, it's similar, except the opposite. In that, they're trying to soften the blow. In the wildfires, they're trying to instill fear.
Zed's trying to listen on the radio. Why don't you go give him a quick hookup? And I'll tell you folks about Allen's Record Service. Allen's Record Service, 578-6300. Allen is your go-to tow-to. I was by there the other day, and they had rearranged the lot on a Saturday. And, man, there were tow trucks galore. Allen can haul, tow, lift, carry, anything you need. Has up to a 75-ton crane. He can pick up the biggest of the big rigs. The VCS companies and the only locally owned and authorized AT&T retailer help you with all your communication needs. The Hartman family, the Hartman Communication Empire, as we call it, has been around for over 50 years. Started out with a ranch radio store. One rancher would reach out to another on a designated frequency. It was really handy back in the day. Now, they do entire networks for folks like the Victoria County Sheriff's Office. Justin Marr oversaw that project, got new radios in a lot of the vehicles. VCS companies do it. Chesnick Furniture Company for over 100 years downtown, 116 West Wan Lynn. The corner of Wan Lynn and Bridge. Chesnick and Love make your house a home. Stop by today and see why you just always do better at Chesnick. Great folks, great family. Bobby Leon will come out and talk to you about Best Recliners, Tempur-Pedic bedding. Just helping you get what you want. He's not trying to sell you anything. Go by. Let Bobby Leon help you make your family happier. And then Veracruz today on a Monday. Magnificent Monday at Veracruz. You can have your Taco Tuesday. You can have your Caldo Wednesday. It's a great way to start the week, get by Veracruz. I recommend, especially for those of you that like it spicy, get the spicy fajita beef taco salad. Tell them to cut the chips. The chips come in a basket. They have the best hot sauce in town, so you can eat all the chips and hot sauce you want, salsa. But you need the taco salad, spicy beef, fajita, taco salad. I even sometimes put the salsa on as a dressing. It's just phenomenal. My partner's making his way back. Did he solve the problem? Was it an easily solvable problem? Was it a repetitive task for Mr. Posey?
No. The last time this happened, somebody was in here messing around and disconnecting things, and they did not put them back properly.
There's a lot of chefs in the Magic 95.9 FM kitchen. There's a number of us. Like right now, Ash and I are the only people in the building. At 6:15 this morning, Bill Posey's the only person in the building. So there's not somebody here 24/7 who's saying, don't touch that.
No.
And every now and then, the night crew gets a little too much cough syrup, and the next thing you know, they're doing things they shouldn't be doing.
So, good morning to Zed Stewart, Buddy Stavanoan checking in, the Iceman, Dottie Bitterly, Justin Glass, Brent Anderson, Stephen Kidder, Jared McCrugan, Diane Tippett, Michelle Wilson-Hawkins, Carrie Bump, Rena Scherer, good morning, Amanda Smith-King, Scott Snow, Ricky King, Christina Wise, Scott Tomko, good morning, everybody.
You know, I had an interesting conversation. I saw our buddy, not even in question whether he's our friend, Patrick Strauss. It's not even a question. But Patrick has an edge about the program. And the other day he said, well, that's why I don't check in. Brent talks about the Catholic Church and he talks about Aggies, and I'm both. And in my mind, I'm like this, look, every now and then you've got to talk about an institution that's a cult, that's totally drifted from its original mission, and on occasion you talk about the Catholic Church. I mean, you know, so the Aggies are the cult that have drifted away from their original mission, totally lost.
College football is the cult that's drifted away from its original mission.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We love Patrick Strauss. I hope he checks back in. If he's in, I hope he at least, you know, lets us know he's there. So you've got to figure out. Aggies are firmly convinced 10-2 this year. Connor Wegman, a dark horse Heisman candidate. All because, here's what gets me. They hired the equivalent of St. Peter when they hired Jimbo Fisher. He's won a natty in Florida State. I'm like, well, wait a minute. He won a natty with Jameis Winston, a once-in-a-lifetime player. And, oh, by the way, he went 5-7 or 7-5, whatever he went. That Florida State was like, ah.
Yeah.
When he left.
Couldn't wait to get rid of him.
Oh, man. But no. You don't understand. He's got the tools now to make things happen. Comes out as that fluke year with COVID. Last year goes 5-7. They bring in Bobby Petrino. But now they're poised to go because Petrino is the man.
You think?
They may be pretty good.
Well, yeah, I think they'll be all right. I think 9-3 is kind of where they end up. 7-5 this year.
7-5.
8-6 or 8-4.
Becomes.
8-4.
I got them losing. So early on, they play New Mexico. They're going to come back and play. Which in New Mexico? Who plays Abilene Christian? We're in the SEC. We're
nobody after next year when the two conferences go to 20 teams and they got no room for these games.
Well, that's when the Aggies will go 5-5 all the time. It's the dumbest thing ever to play Abilene Christian. We all play Rice. Rice is a D1 program.
So is Abilene Christian.
Yeah, but come on.
It's not a dumb move for Abilene Christian. They're going to get paid probably $2 million.
Probably. And free hotel rooms with breakfast. But
It's the mob world equivalent of the mob paying you to shoot yourself.
Right. Yeah, just a shot through your foot.
We're going to give you $2 million.
But you need a bullet wound.
But you've got to have a bullet wound.
Absolutely.
Or we're going to pay your family the money for, and here's the gun, kill yourself.
So they'll either lose two, they will lose one of Miami or Arkansas. They'll find a way to lose to one of those teams. Probably not Miami. They'll be probably 3-0. They'll lose to Arkansas. They will lose to LSU, Tennessee, and Alabama. There's three losses. I gave you four with one of those two.
I agree with those three.
And they'll also lose to one of whoever it is, the Mississippi schools they play.
Our internet's lagging a little bit.
They'll lose.
Let me try to get there real quick.
One of those.
We can really figure out who that other one they will lose to is.
Okay.
And then just in an equal opportunity.
Oh, I can tell you. I can tell you. Texas is going to lose too.
So
they beat New Mexico. Yeah. Let's say they.
They're not playing Abilene Christian, are they? Oh yeah, at the end of the season.
Oh yeah, got that open date between there and the SEC championship.
Won't have it anymore.
So they play New Mexico. They beat them. The Lobos, for those of you that don't know. Then they'll play Miami, and I just know enough about Miami to think the Aggies will beat Miami. 2:30 in the afternoon on ABC.
You got inside information over there?
Yeah. Then they will beat Louisiana Monroe. When you
Which
play
is a step up over Abilene Christian.
Yeah, but they're playing the ULALA Raging Cajuns. Yippee! They'll beat them.
Oh, they're playing. What is Monroe? Another Raging Cajuns.
No, they're not. Oh, they're a step down from the Raging Cajuns. I'm sorry. So they lose one of two to Auburn or Arkansas, who they play back-to-back, September 23rd, September 30th.
The Warhawks, Monroe Warhawks.
If they beat Auburn, they'll lose to Arkansas, and or vice versa. Heaven forbid if they lose them both.
Four straight home games, starting with the Warhawks of mighty Louisiana
but
Monroe.
If they lose them both, if they lose to Auburn and they lose to Arkansas, well, we were looking ahead to Arkansas. Well, we were looking ahead to Alabama. And, well, we were looking ahead to undefeated Tennessee at that point. They could lose four in a row. But I've only got them losing
four
three.
Four.
I've only got them losing three. Then they play South Carolina and Ole Miss and Mississippi State.
Might lose
that game on the road at Mississippi State.
No, it's at home. They're at Ole Miss.
Oh, one of those they're going to lose. They'll beat Abilene Christian, and they'll lose to LSU. So let's go through it. They win, they win, they win. They win and lose, so they're 4-1 after 6 weeks, 5 weeks. Then they're going to drop back-to-back to be 4-3 to Alabama and Tennessee. Then they're going to go 1-1 and be 5-4 with South Carolina and Ole Miss. Let's go this. They'll be 6-4 after they play. I'll give them another win. South Carolina, Ole Miss, Mississippi State. They'll be 7-4 after beating Abilene Christian, which ought to be not on TV. And then they'll be 7-5 if they lose to
LSU.
And
it's not. It's on ESPN Plus and the SEC Network.
Yeah.
Plus.
After they lose to LSU, they will be 7-5. And that's best case?
I could see them being 8-4 best case. I don't see a 9-win season in this schedule at all for Texas.
And if they do have a 9-win season, hats off to them.
And I'm the objective one in this.
I agree. I'm the one that giggles when they lose, but I'm objective when I look at their schedule.
Now, just to keep it fair and balanced.
Okay. 12-0.
Well, let's go here to the Texas Longhorns. They beat Rice.
They beat Rice.
They lose to Alabama.
Let's say they lose to Alabama. By the way, between me and you, Texas is going to beat Alabama this year. At Alabama. At Alabama.
So they're 1-1.
They're 1-1. They beat Wyoming 2-1. They beat Baylor. They beat Kansas. They're now 3-1.
Don't they struggle with Kansas every year?
Yeah, no, not every year.
Almost every year?
No. So they're 4-1 after they lose to Alabama. They beat Oklahoma.
I could see them losing one of Wyoming or Baylor.
You can't see Texas losing to Wyoming with any logic other than we've just sucked for a decade. There's no logic that a ranked Texas team is going to lose to Wyoming.
What's Texas ranked
right at
now?
At home.
What's Texas ranked right
seven?
Now?
Seven.
Overrated, as they always
they
are.
They always are overrated. Now, I will not dispute that, sir.
And that's why.
Let's go look at the Wyoming
Cowboys.
Well,
Cowboys. No, Wyoming's, they play Tech, Portland State, Texas.
App State, that's a tough team.
New Mexico, well, you, when you get into conference,
these are teams
you
that beat
the
Aggies. App State, New Mexico State. Fresno State, Boise State, Colorado State.
When you get into conference, you can only
play who they give
you. Yep. Wyoming's sneakily fairly good.
Beat Rice, lose to Bama.
Yep.
You lose one
of. I think they lose one of the next three.
So that after that, you're 3-2. You're going to lose to Oklahoma? You want to be a loser to Oklahoma?
They lose to Oklahoma.
All right, they're 3-3.
They beat Houston. They beat BYU.
5-3. You want them to lose to Kansas State?
I
mean, Kansas State's ranked four higher than.
I think they beat Kansas State.
6-3.
TCU plays them tough? I don't know.
TCU's got no quarterback.
True.
So they lose 6-4.
7-4, 8-4.
You got them going 8-4. I got them going 10-2.
All right. So we'll meet in the middle. It'll be 9-3.
Yeah. Okay. But your SEC family, your SEC fans.
I see both Texas.
They're going to tell
you. Both those schools, A&M and Texas, having similar records at the end of the year.
They're telling
me, if not the same record.
A&M has a tougher schedule. Alabama, number 4. Oklahoma, top 20. Kansas State, top 20. TCU, top 20. We're not playing Abilene Christian and New Mexico School for the Blind.
You're playing Rice, close enough.
It's tough. But same thing. It's a program pattern. Gives them a lot of money that they don't need.
So it's four ranked teams, right?
Yeah.
J. just to see here. I think it's
Aggies played number four Alabama, teams. Just like us, and 12 and 22.
And five.
LSU and five. I think LSU's overrated. Yeah, I do too. I think LSU's overrated. I have to tell you,
that's where we
I go. Can't believe I'm going to say this on the radio, but
Steve Kidder says Texas might lose to Baylor.
No, they won't. Baylor's so far back to being Baylor, they don't know what to do. I would really like to see, and TCU is back to being purple Baylor. I would like to see the Aggies run the table. One time. Just run the table. 12-0. Hasn't happened in my lifetime. In fact, the last
could you deal with that?
Oh yeah. Yeah. For sure. I don't think you could. Oh, I'd love it. And the last time that the Aggies won a natty was the last time Southern California had to brace for a tropical storm.
Casey Lynn Kipp checking in. Tom Price, Greg Garcia, Sheriff Lauterbach, good morning.
Why is the
Matt Boucher, Cody Bauman?
Why are we having internet issues?
I don't know. Could just be Junior's internet out there.
Could be.
Where he is in the sticks.
Hope Junior's feeling better.
So
we haven't gotten all the details yet. This is a medical minute brought to you folks by Reality. There's no HIPAA here. I'm not a doctor. What they were going to do.
Did say at a Holiday Inn Express last night.
What they were going to do, folks, was go in through Junior's unit.
Steve Kidder says Texas will win 3 to 4 more games than the Aggies.
Up and into his bladder and grab a hold of a kidney stone and take it out.
It's the medical equivalent of Bruce Willis landing on an asteroid to blow it up.
Right. Somewhere, we are not passing any judgment here. Somewhere in that system, something was too small. That's all I'm going to say. Junior tried to lay it off as the stone was too big. We think it's relative.
Junior has no stones that are too big.
Right. And our observation, something in that area was too small for the surgery to be successful.
Or their equipment was too big.
Right.
They mismeasured. They took Junior at his word.
They went with the pediatric equipment in a quest.
When they needed the neonatal
They could
equipment.
Not get in there. So, yeah. The law offices of Steve Kidder, if we just got sued over HIPAA.
There's no HIPAA there.
Steve Kidder's there to help us. He'll just say, of course they're guilty, Your Honor. Go easy.
We're not doctors. We're not releasing privileged information. These are things he told us.
He was in the Navy.
We're extrapolating.
Thousands of people who know how little that thing is. He was in the Navy.
True story.
People saw it on the ship or didn't see it as it might be.
Until he sneezed.
Drip, drip, drip. Steve Kidder's there to help you with all your legal needs.
Gray Barn open at 8, 10 o'clock.
Ish.
Stop on by the Gray Barn Mercantile right there on Airline and Laurel.
That's what I love about Uncle Mutt's Barbecue. You walk up and on the door it says open about 11. About Ish. 11. Atzenhofer and Atzenhofer.com. I tell you what looks pretty sharp.
What's that?
I don't know if I could drive one, but looks like more expensive than I think it is. Two things. Both the Mitsubishi and the Mazda little SUV.
The Mazda CX-90 is a...
It is a nice-looking vehicle.
And it's sporty, got a lot of power. I think it's the most powerful Mazda ever built.
There you go.
So there you go.
The rotary Wankel engine. In Australia, the rotary Wanka.
Please.
The Wanka engine.
Way to use Wankel in a complete sentence.
There
this
you have it. Get by Adson Offer since 1926.
You buy the CX90, you want to take it over to AJ's Detailing as soon as you drive it off the lot, and he'll make sure you put a ceramic coat on it. So those rock chips will not chip your paint.
Yep.
It won't fade your paint. Nothing.
Armor Air at 579-0966 for all your AC needs. Did you know that So Chevrolet is coming out with their most powerful Corvette ever, the new Corvette Z06.
I passed a pretty cool one when I first saw it on the road coming home on Saturday morning. I thought it was an old Ford GT.
You passed it in your Corolla?
Yes.
Nice.
Because it was that blue color and it had two orange racing stripes, but from a distance it looked like one stripe down the back.
Very cool.
And it was a brand new Corvette, or newish Corvette, the new model, the mid-engine. What is this, eighth generation Corvette? Is that right?
It's a C8, yes, sir.
Okay. Was trying to keep up here. And this, I passed this old man driving that thing.
Did he pass you back?
No. He only passed me when I stopped at Bucky's because I had to pee.
Pimping ain't easy.
And then
the tortoise.
And then I passed him again.
You were the hare.
Yes. And I don't know where he was going, but man, it was a nice looking car, and the color combination was just striking.
Well, they're at the point now where they're saying that if you buy the thing, you have to make a commitment to own it for a certain period of time or a certain number of miles. And if you decide to flip it, because they're like, for example, Atzenhofer says they can probably only get Atzenhofer only has allotment for two of the things. And they've got people wanting to put down money to order a bunch of them. And the problem is, what will happen is capitalism. I'll buy one. Ash wants it. I'll pay $150 for it, and I'll sell it to you for $200, but it's only got 3 miles on it, and you'll buy it. Here's what happens. When you buy it, all the warranties go away. Chevrolet is saying, no, you will not juice the price. This is America's affordable sports car. We're not doing this.
So they're anti-capitalists.
Well, they're
GM.
They're pro-consumer. At the end of the day, what they're going to do is they're going to guarantee a market. This is a car that's like 750 horsepower. I mean, it's amazing. Yeah. Linda Crist, who is married to Junior, says, as a conscientious observer, not objector, observer, in Junior's life.
This time she's a conscientious objector.
Things did not go as planned. She's talking about their honeymoon. She's not talking about
the 30 years
of
marriage. probably a phrase she's uttered frequently and often. Things did not go as planned. But isn't that almost hypocritical of General Motors for doing that?
It is, except they saw what happened with the Ford GT. People were buying them for $100 and selling them on the other market for $400.
Catherine Iams says, I would continue prayers for you. I have to have that done in December. I had to have that done in December. The recovery was the worst pain in her life ever. And this is the lady who's given birth. Hi. So what do you make of Donald Trump just saying, you know what?
Give me just a little, just a little volume.
Everybody sings this one. I want to hear everybody join in.
The great Chuck Berry.
When I was a little bitty boy.
Special request out for Junior Samples this morning. There you go. Get well, Junior. We love you.
So Linda Chris sent that one out.
Donald Trump got a long distance request. Long distance dedication.
Yeah, we kid, but I know Junior's in a lot of pain.
I still listen to American Top 40.
Do you?
On Sirius. And it's a trip because like 1973.
Oh, the throwback.
The real ones.
On Yacht Rock.
On 70s on 7. And you've got Casey Kasem going, this is the latest album from a young Brit who's had a couple of hits, and it's Elton John.
Yeah.
You know? He's rising the charts today with a Rocket Man. You're like, wow. Wow.
Young man.
Yeah. He's a young man, little Brit. Donald Trump.
Flashy.
Announces. Not going to the debate.
Probably not going to any of the debates. Says he has nothing to gain by going on the debates, and his record speaks for itself.
They know what kind of president I was. Yeah, I don't need to go talk to those idiots.
And I get it, but here's the problem I have with that. then why are you going on and doing an interview with Tucker Carlson?
So you can talk about what a great president you were, uninterrupted, in a friendly environment. How many people were in that debate?
Yeah, good question. I don't know how many people are in the debate.
I think I read there were 9.
Let's see. See if we can. Can anybody name 5 of them?
I can name 5. Name 9. I can give you Vimek Ramaswamy.
Brett Baer is going to moderate it. I mean, how bad is that?
He's got great hair. I can give you Vimek Ramaswamy. I can give you Mike Pence. Yeah. I can give you Chris Christie, the donut-eating doughboy. I can give you
Nikki Haley.
And there was a 5th one that I knew. You and I talked about it. Pence, Nikki, Christie, Vivek.
Former governor of Arkansas. If that helps you at all.
The girl?
Asa Hutchinson.
Don't know him.
Okay.
Don't know him.
Here's the list of those.
Ron DeSantis. Oh, yeah, DeSantis. I apologize. That was not humor.
I thought you mentioned him already.
That wasn't humor. DeSantis was so obvious it didn't cross my mind.
I apologize. Doug Burgum, governor of North Dakota.
Never heard of him. 67 years old, senior vice president of Microsoft Business. You think Bill Gates is trying to get him in there?
Nah, he left in 07.
He's only a billionaire.
Well, here's why. He was great president of the Great Plains Software. Microsoft probably bought him out.
He's rich.
Chris Christie should just hang it up. This guy is... he's got no chance.
No.
And he's a rhino. Let's be honest.
Yeah, he's just...
Larry Elder.
I like Larry Elder. I do too. Zero chance to be elected president. Makes too much sense.
Nikki Haley.
I like her.
Former governor of South Carolina, former ambassador to the United Nations. Will Hurd is representative from Texas, San Antonio area.
Look, did you ever, be honest, you ever heard of Will Hurd?
Nope, I've heard of Sam Hurd.
So here's a guy who not only is he a Texan, he's a Republican. He is a peer of Michael Cloud. I've never heard the man's name, Will Hurd.
3-term representative.
Will Unheard.
More or less. Asa Hutchinson was part of W's cabinet, needs to go away. We do not need you, 72 years old.
He was an administrator for the DEA.
Yeah, we don't need you, Asa Hutchinson. What are you going to do?
He's going to talk about securing the border. Yeah. That's all he's going to talk about.
Because he was the Undersecretary of Homeland Security.
Yeah.
Did you not have an opportunity from 03 to 05 to influence our border policy?
Right.
Didn't do anything. Bye-bye.
Perry Johnson is the founder of Perry Johnson Registrars. What is that?
I have no idea.
How do you register to vote?
I don't know. Is that one of those federal registries where all those companies that just need a representative in the United States hire somebody to represent them?
And what does this mean? His claim to fame is he's a disqualified candidate for governor of Michigan.
I don't know. Let's find out.
Craziness.
No, it's not going to let us do it.
And then you've got Mike Pence, who I think is just weak as bathwater. From Indiana, Mike Pence.
Vivek Ramaswamy.
I like that dude.
Tim Scott, senator from South Carolina. Francis Suarez, the mayor of Miami. This guy's been, I've been impressed with listening to Francis Suarez. I don't think he has a chance. I don't even think he's going to get on the debate stage because I don't think he's polling high enough.
No, they're only letting 9 on the stage. These 9.
Yeah,
Binkley, Hurd, Suarez, and Elder don't have the votes.
And it's too bad for Elder because I think he would do well. But of those candidates, I think there's 2 that have an opportunity to really, I think, make a name. Ron DeSantis is like 40 points behind Donald Trump with the latest. I think it was a CBS poll. Had Trump like 42 points ahead of DeSantis. But I think...
And together, they probably have 75% of the vote.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Probably so. But I think the two candidates that I think have the biggest opportunity, maybe there's three. But I think Vivek Ramaswamy.
Nikki Haley.
Yep. And Tim Scott.
Okay. I don't know who Tim Scott is.
Senator from South Carolina. Former state rep there. Former congressman as well. I don't think Mike Pence does anything. I don't think DeSantis brings you anything you haven't seen or heard from him. So I don't know. What do you think? Peter McNally says Herd knows the border problems.
We all know the border problems, and welcome, Pete. We all know the border problem. You know, in an ideal world, we'd go back to allowing 1 million people a year into our country legally. They would show up with some identification in legitimate family units, not seeking asylum, and they would say, we want to come live in America. Here's our paperwork. Here's who we are. Here's where we're from. God bless America. They would come in. They would go through the process. They would assimilate. They would learn the language. They would contribute. It would be beautiful. Nah, not going to happen. Here you go. Trump, five rivals. Bum, bum, bum.
Politico. The thing is, I think the two we've talked about, Vivek Ramaswamy and Nikki Haley, I think probably have the biggest chance to really make some noise in this debate. But neither one of them will ever get enough points to overtake Trump. And or even probably DeSantis, to be honest.
How are you going to have a debate with 8 or 9 participants and anybody have sufficient time to change anybody's mind?
Well, I was listening to a gentleman this morning, Mike Slater, and he said, what does the debate actually prove? What skill set is demonstrated or observed on a debate stage that is critical for being the leader of the free world? And, you know, he's kind of got a point to that in a way.
The only thing would be the ability to let it roll off your back. You know, if you get attacked, to just go, well, you're entitled to that opinion, but have you thought about this, this, and this?
I got to thinking of that this morning. I always find it interesting when they talk about DeSantis and Trump and the things that are said, and then there was rumors that DeSantis might accept a cabinet position in a Trump administration, and then the left was unhinged at the attacks that Donald Trump had on Ted Cruz. And they conveniently forget that our vice president, cackling Kamala Harris, called Joe Biden a racist in the debate. John Williams says he's more of a fan of town halls. I agree with that. I like them. I think the problem I have with the debates is you have such a limited time that you have more time to give your opening and closing statements than you do to discuss the issues. And that's the problem. They give their canned elevator speech at the start. They give their canned elevator speech at the end. And you never really hear of how they're going to address any of the issues. And they give you all the gobbledygook. We're going to fix the border. I don't care about you telling me you're going to fix the border. I want to know your plan to fix the border.
Steve Kidder says, let them all talk for 3 minutes. The problem is,
our spans of attention aren't 3 minutes long, but what they should do, if there's 9 qualified candidates, have a 2-night debate stage. Pull names out of a hat. Throw 4 or 5 of them on the first day. Throw the next 4 on the second day. And then let's go at it a little bit.
Agree.
Stop with the phrasing of the questions the way they do to lead the contestants to an answer that they want to hear. Throw out more general topics and ask the specifics. How will you fix our border problem? And then if they start going off on their campaign speech, well, we're going to fix the border because we have to fix the border. And if we don't fix the border's not going to fix itself. then shut their mics off and move on and move on to the next one. If you're not going to give specifics on how you plan to address the issues that are ailing this country, then shut up, sit down, move on to the next
one. And learn something.
And get the hell off that debate stage because you have no business being on there. If you can't go into specifics enough to let American voters know how you plan to address the problems that you say ail this country as a candidate for president, and you can't give us at least enough of a specific to say, okay, I can get behind that, or no, that's a crappy plan, then get the hell off that stage and drop out now.
Callie Froman makes a good point. In debates, the one-liners and zingers can shut down a candidate or elevate him. Substance is then lost. And I agree, it's really not, there's not time for a lot of substance. There's time. You want everybody the next day at the water cooler to go, did you see Nikki Haley in that debate last night?
She called Tim Scott an idiot.
Right.
Right? That's what those are the takeaways from these things. And that's the problem with them. Steve Kidder says elimination night the first night. Top three move on to this night two.
What is this, like America's Got Talent? That's what you need. You need what's his name? What's the dude's name?
Simon Cowell?
Yeah. You need that guy. They can vote.
Not Howie Mandel.
No, not Howie. Howie's like, don't touch me.
It's Katina Arterberry checking in. Chris says she'll be watching Tucker. See, and I don't want to watch Tucker. I know everything I need to know about Donald Trump.
I know everything that Donald's going to say. Junior Simple says that one zinger removed Jimmy Carter. The greatest zinger ever in debate history was the night that Lloyd Benson looked at one young Dan Quayle and said, son, I knew John F. Kennedy. John F. Kennedy was a friend of mine, and you're no John F. Kennedy. Bam! Just drop the mic and walk off the stage. I'm not debating idiot any longer.
Didn't get Lloyd Benson elected either.
No, but it sure put Quayle in his spot forever. Dan Quayle was never heard from again. He's only about 55 years old now. He's still alive, just plays golf. Frat boy. He turned into Brett Kavanaugh. He's now on the Supreme Court.
But Trump won't debate the contestants, and then he won't let the contestants debate without him by him being on Tucker. And I think it's the same night, is it not? Is he going to be on Tucker Wednesday?
Yeah. Steve Kidder points out, Kamala Harris called Biden a racist and became VP.
Yeah,
probably in part for Biden to fight being labeled a racist. I mean, hey, Nikki Haley should call everybody, what is it, a xenophobe that doesn't like women?
Yeah.
You should call them
misogynist.
Oh, yeah, you're all misogynist. The whole lot of you are misogynist. And they'll pick her as a VP running mate. And she's probably in a pretty good spot to be a VP running mate.
Probably so.
Check the box. Get a woman. Click. But for the Republicans, hey, it's a white woman. Click. Yeah, I can see it happening.
Apparently his interview with Tucker Carlson is going to be released after it's recorded. It won't be live.
So it's propaganda. You think Trump demanded final edit?
Probably.
Propaganda, folks.
No, I wouldn't think Tucker has. I would think Tucker has enough journalistic integrity to say nope.
Would you?
I would hope so. If it ever came out that he acquiesced to Trump's demands for editing that thing, then Tucker's career would be over.
You mean after he gets his cabinet appointment?
Yes.
Do we trust any of them, folks? And should we trust any of them? Power corrupts. Should we trust any of them?
I mean, if you really think about it, Vivek Ramaswamy is the only self-made billionaire on that panel. Even Donald Trump got all his money from his dad.
And then you've got Barack Obama going, he didn't build that. American people built that. They bought his stuff. Without us, he'd be nothing.
And I'm even going to take it one step further with Vivek. He's a first-generation American. I think he probably loves this country more than any other candidate in the Republican field.
You're only saying that because you're biased as a first-generation American.
I'm not a first-generation American.
You're just an immigrant.
My kids are.
Squatter. Callie Fromme says Clayton Williams' rape comment in Texas governor debate was his downfall. It was, and I still... Yeah, I can't spin it. That was still a really dumb thing to say. You may recall Clayton Williams said something about, man, it's like whatever he was talking about, what the taxes or whatever, it's like rape. If it's inevitable, you should just relax and enjoy it. Dumb thing to say. You know, and certainly did not, Clady wasn't, all Clayton Williams had to do, and maybe this is where Donald Trump's getting his playbook, all Clayton Williams had to do is disappear. Go to Wyoming and go fishing, and he'd have been governor. Then you can say whatever dumb stuff you want. But instead...
Unless you're Ken Paxton.
Yeah.
Steve Kidder says, I thought Tucker's career was over. I don't think he's probably got... You know, it's interesting. Tucker was the savior of Fox News when they got rid of Bill O'Reilly. Tucker's numbers were only, at the best... We're about half of what O'Reilly was pulling in on Fox News.
I wonder what O'Reilly's on a private deal probably now on like.
Well, he's writing series. All his books, right? And his, I mean,
he's a gazillionaire.
I don't know that his Killing series is that great a literary accomplishment and achievement every time.
It's interesting. It's an easy
because they're
read.
They're starting to follow a formula, right?
Right.
I mean, you can basically just insert name here on the title, and the book is almost the exact same every time. But they sell millions. He's making a bunch of money. But
you think maybe Trump's taking a page from the Clayton Williams book and just saying, hey, I'm going to disappear. I'm not going to say anything stupid. And
I think he's trying to help Tucker's career, and this will be a Twitter thing or X thing or whatever they call it. I still never refer to it as X. It just sounds stupid.
X.
I think he's trying to help Tucker.
What did you make of your president meeting with the Japanese head Shaka Khan, I think, and like an underling of Kim Jong-un?
I mean,
does that matter? They were at Camp David, I think. They had a casual get-together.
I don't know why we're even... recognizing North Korea.
Solid.
On any front. Whether it's Trump, whether it's Biden.
They've got a nuke. You have to recognize that.
Well, and that's probably the reason why they met with Japan and them, right? Because Japan's got issues or
what
concerns.
Do you make of your buddy Zelensky?
Meeting with the Dutch
and celebrating publicly the arrival of F-16 fighter aircraft to protect Ukraine. I always think that's funny. I can give you a fighter jet tomorrow. Can you fly it? And just because you're a pilot in the Ukraine Air Force, can you fly an F-16? I don't understand. Unless we're sending advisors.
Is the Taliban able to fly those planes we left behind?
No, and the problem is we didn't leave. What I've read is as much as it was a dumb thing to do to leave $85 billion worth of equipment over there, it is probably, as of now, useless to them.
Some of it is, some of it isn't.
Yeah. A lot of the equipment is maintenance heavy, and they didn't leave them a cachet of parts.
Well, but they did leave some. I mean, they left a lot of night scope stuff and things that you sell it to the Russians, and now they have our close to first gen technology.
I didn't know that I was Tibetan. I'm going to share this with you on a Monday. We have a saying in Tibet: if a problem can be solved, there's no use worrying about it. If it can't be solved, worrying will do you no good. My dad always said, if you can do something about it, do something about it. If you can't, take it off your list. I like it.
It is. That's an interesting. You were telling me this morning before we got here that Russia had sent a probe to the moon. I thought they'd been there before. They send dogs. Yeah. Remember all that? How did they spin that one?
Well, they didn't say. See right here in America on, what are we on, Epic Times? It says Russia's Luna 25 lunar probe reportedly crashed while trying to land on the moon's south pole. The Russians in there.
There's the problem. You're trying to land on the bottom when you need to be landing on the top. Because trying to get on the bottom.
On the top.
At the bottom, you just fall off.
Come on. That's where all the water is. The Russians made a statement. Of course, it was being translated into English, but it basically said.
Well, and I always wonder if those translators aren't messing with people that don't know the language, right?
The translation said that the lunar lander went into an uncontrolled orbit and disintegrated when struck by the moon's surface.
Making it seem like the moon reached out and grabbed it.
Yeah. I was doing great till that car jumped out in front of me. That's kind of what happened there.
India's heading there next. This week they've got a spacecraft that'll make an arrival on the moon.
Think the moon over here. We think the moon's made of cheese. Over there, they think it's made of curry powder.
If we've been to the moon, why are we going back?
There's no. Haven't we learned it?
What I mean, what can we learn that we didn't learn 50 years ago?
Yeah.
Right.
100% agree.
Why aren't we just trying to get to Mars?
Well, we need a depot. We need to stop there, stage some stuff, and then go on. Astros update brought to you by the great folks at First State Bank of Louise, the little most friendly bank in the whole region, in the world. Friendliest bank anywhere. First State Bank of Louise. Astros lose 3 in a row over the weekend to the Seattle Mariners. The good news being the palatable, tolerable news being that the Rangers also dropped their 3 games against the Milwaukee Brewers.
Doesn't make it right.
No, they're still 2.5 games back. We could be half a game up by just taking care of business. Notable along the way, Jose Altuve collects his 2,000th hit. The Astros seem to have gotten Rafael Montero untracked. He seems to be pitching better.
He's the only one.
Yiner Diaz really hitting the ball well. The big man, John Singleton, settling in at first a little bit. Mauricio Dubon playing some center field. Astros have been a ragtag bunch. I can't wait to get our friend Bill, our dear friend, close personal friend, Bill Brown, back on the air with us. I listened to Bagwell yesterday.
Yeah.
So you got Robert Ford in the booth. You know, it's like, it's a long fly ball. See you later. And Bagwell goes, slider hung there a little bit. And he just powdered it. And I'm just sitting there, and I'm listening to him the other day. He says he won't see anything in this at-bat but slider away. And, of course, they throw slider, slider, slider. And Robert goes, Baggy, it's almost like you've been there time or two. I'm like, hey, Mr. Excitement.
Get me wrong.
He's a genius about the game, but he's terrible in the booth.
Experiment needs to end.
Or
coach him.
Oh, give him another gummy. He sounds like he's about to pass out. I ate the nachos in the helmet. Strike.
They were good.
Oh, Bregman hit a Mariners ball
really, Mariners really took it to us, didn't
they? Oh, they're tough. Their pitching's good. And Scott Servais managed the game like it was playoffs. Brought in a 8th-inning guy in the 4th inning.
Got to do what you got to do sometimes.
Yeah.
Here's the thing with the Astros, and frank discussion, fans. This Astros team, not as good as the previous 5 teams.
No, they're going to have to actually play ball to win.
And everybody's going to have to be on their game. Well, and you can make excuses. Well, we've had injuries.
Everybody has injuries.
Dana Brown's job then to go out and replace those guys that he knew wasn't going to be there this year. McCullers, Urquidy. Our pitching is terrible.
Unfortunately, Urquidy's been on the mound even though he hadn't been there.
We've had, I think, the top 5, maybe 6 batters have been really good. 7, 8, 9 have been problematic. Some games, number 6 hitters have been problematic.
Yep. Scott Tomko says there'll be a 7-Eleven on the moon in 24 after India lands there.
So I just think the Astros got to – they're not that good, and I don't know that Dana Brown in his first year of GM addressed the issues.
What do you do when you get to the moon and there's a 7-Eleven there and you've got your lunar module and they tell you, I'm sorry, I'm out of rocket fuel.
There's no gas to be found. No fuel.
You go up there, there's a little plastic bag over the pump. It's not good. This is no good. You know what Victoria needs to become the leader in?
What's that?
Desalinization. We need to build
a desalinization plant?
Huge.
Right up the barge canal.
Yes.
Let that pump that water up the canal.
Somebody would sue us for taking water out of the ocean.
Probably so.
Man. Folks, USA Concrete Coating, let Charlie Garcia and his team come in and put down a tough as nails polyurethane coat.
Won't crack, peel or fade.
Right. Won't crack, stick, peel or fade. There's my dyslexic buddy chiming in. They do a great job. 578 Home. Wint Services for all your generator needs and just general electrical work. They've worked for both Ash and me. They do it all, and they're fantastic folks.
They really are.
Extremely fair. Kiss you right on the back of the neck before they give you that invoice. White Trash Services, 550-1826.
I've got a roll-off delivered. It'll be filled up here in the next week or two, and then they'll come take it away.
Would they just give you like a quarterly rate to fit your busy schedule, or what do you do?
Very reasonable.
There you go.
550. I would waste more gas and time trying to get all that stuff to the dump than them coming out, dropping me off a roll-off, and taking it one time.
550-1826. And the Chopping Block today on Monday. What's the special?
I hadn't heard yet this morning, so... But stop on by. They always have.
They're too busy cooking to be giving us info.
They always have great food, though. I've not tried anything there that's not good.
Astros play tonight. Play the Boston Red Sox, I believe, at Boston. I believe. Do you know?
No, but I just pulled that down, so I can't even check.
Let's just go look. I know the Astros play tonight. I just don't know where they play.
And I'm fairly positive. Is it a three-game losers? Yeah.
They play Boston. I believe at.
No, at home.
No, at home. Oh, good. We'll beat the Red Sox.
Javier.
Christian Javier.
Against Paxton.
There you go. Folks, it's.
Javier's record's a little misleading given that ERA of 4.5 a game.
Yeah. Man, over the weekend, I saw where the other night when Justin Verlander was pitching and the Astros scored 12 runs, but he left the game. It was 6-5.
Yeah.
Did you know that in his career, Justin Verlander is 103-0 when his team gives him 5 runs.
Well, he needed every single one of them the other night.
But think about it. You're talking about a guy who never gives up the lead when he's got 5 runs. Never gives it up. There you go.
How many no decisions, I wonder?
I don't know.
But he hasn't lost.
Party Cooper. Love you guys. Have a great day. We're out of here.
See you all from the South Texas TV studio. We'll be back here tomorrow. Bye,
folks.